record of your visit with us. So these fellas, if you will, they're standing here in front of you. They want to give you a card to fill out so that we can remember you as our special visitor for today. So if you're visiting with us for the first time or the first time in a long time, and would you just lift your hand up? We're not going to make you stand up or anything like that, but if you're visiting with us, including our community heroes, if you'd do that, we'd be so kind. We'd be so grateful if you would do that. Thank you so much. A lot of familiar faces here today. And all on this day, we've set aside. Thank you so much for being here. If you'll just hold it up for just a minute while they come down the aisle. While they're doing that, let me make some very brief announcements. I hope every one of you got the opportunity to grab a hold of a bulletin. There's a few announcements in there as far as today, immediately following the service. There's lunch for everybody. That's not just the community heroes. I want to make sure that our people are able to spend time and celebrate this special day that we set aside to honor you with you. So the only thing I do ask is that our community heroes will be inside of the main fellowship hall. There where the food and all will be. Those in the church, let's fill up the overflow room first, and then we'll come back in after we get all of our community heroes seated and all of that. So let's make sure that, number one, they are in the front of the line, and number two, that they fill up in the main auditorium or the main fellowship hall first. And then church people, if you'll sit in the car or the children's activity room first, and then once that's filled up, we'll meet in the middle somewhere. So thank you for that. Also been reminded by Tim that if you have children in children's church, they are indeed downstairs this morning, and then you can pick them up downstairs as you leave the main auditorium. They're not going to release them. They'll hold them captive until you come and pick them up. And any left over will be donated to the Salvation Army to a day camp or something. I don't know. But he'll hold them down there so it is an easier transition. Of course, take a look at all of the other things going on in the bulletin. We're looking forward to what the Lord has for us and is doing on this day that we set aside for the community heroes. Also this morning, for those of you that are here for the first time, we always take a minute and recognize those that have had birthdays in the past week, so, and anniversary. So is there anybody here that has had a birthday in the last week? Anybody at all? Now, if you're visiting with us and you want to tell on them, that's even better. So I know Miss Carolyn did. I know. Make her stand up. That's your grandpa there. All right. Isaiah, how old are you, buddy? 17. Do I need to introduce any little girls? There's a lot of visitors here today. All right. 17. All right. And Miss Carolyn, was it yesterday? She got to, but outside of my mom and Miss Carolyn, she got two bars of happy birthday sung to her coming out of Walmart. Then she took off running. I can't figure out what happened. Went to urgent care to fix her bleeding ears. Oh, I doubt that. It comes from the heart. Wonderful. All right. Anybody else for today? How about anniversary this week? Anybody celebrating an anniversary? All right, we're going to sing to these two folks then.
Happy birthday to you.
Thank you.
Department, the chief of Conover Police Department, the chief of the fire department from Conover here, and if I missed somebody, please tell me. Have I missed anybody that I'm trying to figure out if I have. I'm not getting any response from any of them. They're looking at me, so okay. But it is an honor to have all of these folks with us today. I want to make sure that we do that. These folks, first of all, we have in the back to my right, to your left, the regional chief of staff, Patrick McHenry, Roger Pump, here with us. And also, if you'll just stand for a minute, and all. And then we've also got Patrick McHenry's campaign manager, Will Bowen, with us. It's right beside of him. So thank them fellas for coming, if you will. They'll be glad to field any questions you may have. And if you have not voted already, you better vote. As we say around here, if you don't vote, don't yap and complain because you didn't do your God-given constitutional rights. All right. Anyway, over here to my right, a very special lady who has served on the county commission for a while. And I consider a friend, not only a commissioner, but a friend. Ms. Barbara Beatty, will you stand for us and be recognized? If you want to call and talk to her, she will talk to you. And I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean that in a very good way. She is a fine lady. And then we have three other folks that are going to speak this morning. Chief Brown, will you come on up here? And his wife is with him this morning. And this is your chief of Newton Police Department for, what, another few days?
4 weeks.
He is your sheriff-elect for Catawba County. And you give him a warm welcome here.
Service, and I just want to say thank you very much to this congregation. When
we left, we felt welcome, we felt loved, we felt spiritually uplifted. We've talked about that service this entire year, and we're very excited to be back here. And just one little shout out for all that, but you've got the most incredible choir I've ever seen. It's incredible. And every single song that we've heard just puts chills in us, and it's absolutely wonderful. So anyway, thank you very much for having us back. I feel very honored, privileged, and humbled to even be a part of this service today. Thank you for having me here. I slept pretty well last night. I'm sure you did too, and you don't even know why. And the reason I did is because I have that subconscious feeling of safe and security in my home. And it's something that we all just take for granted. But the reason we have that feeling of security in our community is because of our wonderful law enforcement officers, police officers, paramedics, and fire department. I know in my heart that if someone were to break in my home, if my house, unfortunately, were to catch on fire or if I were to be involved in an accident and I were to become injured, I have no doubt that our competent, our professional police officers, fire department, paramedics, first responders would rush in and do whatever they could do, putting their lives in danger to save my life, my family, my home. They do that in a competent, professional manner, and may I add, with some of the best response times in the entire state of North Carolina. I know when I go to work in the morning, I'm coming home in the evening. There's nothing about my duties that's going to prevent me from coming home. Unlike a law enforcement officer, they don't have that same security. When they put on their uniform, when they put on that badge, they check on to duty, they know there's a distinct possibility that they may not be coming home that evening because their duties are to serve and protect us, and sometimes, unfortunately, that puts them in harm's way. They know that every time they put on their uniform. And to me, in my book, that's the true definition of a hero. So please let us remember the brave law enforcement officers that gave their lives in the line of duty just this past year. Please let us remember our own Deputy Jordan Sherrill, a 21-year-old man up in Caldwell County deputy who was in the line of duty just pulling somebody over for an expired tag. And the driver of that motor vehicle pulls out a gun and shoots him in the stomach. Thankfully, Jordan Sherrill survived and is going to be okay. How do we adequately say thank you to our law enforcement officers for that kind of service? We can. I become the district attorney in January. I so look forward. It's going to be my honor to work with law enforcement and doing my small part in supporting them, backing them, and doing whatever I can in my small way to making our lives, our families' lives, our community, and our schools safe and secure. So thank you very, very much.
I don't know that Representative Mitchell Setzer remembers this the first time we met, but I was at a function, I don't remember where, but it's been several years ago, and a gentleman walks up to me and introduces himself, and I introduce myself, and he said to me, he said, pulled out his business card, flipped it over, and wrote down his personal cell phone number. He said, "Preacher, if you ever need anything, here's my direct line. Feel free to call me anytime." And he did that to me, spoke volumes, and met with him several times. He's always opened his door, been more than cordial with me, and listened and all of that. And then even the other day, we were at a shindig, and he must have changed his cell phone number, and he flipped his card over and handed it to me again and said, "Here's my new number." And I thought, well, Praise the Lord, I haven't made him mad yet. So, North Carolina House Representative Mitchell Setzer, will you come and speak for just a moment, and then we'll recognize all of our heroes that are here.
As you all know, the state is safer when the General Assembly is adjourned and away from the legislature. This past year, I asked one of the members if they had a chiropractor in their office as much as they patted themselves on the back. I got a look that was, it was interesting. But I would like to thank you all for having us here today, especially for the reason that we were brought here. There's not a person in this room that at some time in their life has not been touched or will be touched by the blessing of emergency services, law enforcement, medic, fire, the whole gamut. And you don't know how much you're appreciated. When my daddy lived, we called emergency services several times. And when my niece lived, we did also. And at no point was there any hesitation or any denial of service. And you don't know how much of a blessing that is. And I would like to thank you on behalf of the residents of the 89th House District and the residents of Catawba County for your faithful, devoted, and kind service. Because without you, we would be in a dire situation at any given moment. And it is a pleasure to be here. And to quote a lady that used to be over at Cultural Resources when I first became a member, blessed are the brief, for they shall be invited again.
Now here's what we want to do, fellas and ladies, is We want to recognize you, so would you please do us a favor? There's two things that they'll be getting today. They'll get them during the meal. Is first of all, we're going to feed them at the conclusion of today, but we worked it out with one of our local restaurants, Chubby's, over here in the food line. They're going to provide you with a free meal later on. We're going to give you a little slip of paper with a seal from the Emmanuel Baptist. All you have to do is go in and present that, and that will feed you at Chubby's. So go by and thank them for teaming up with us on that. And then we found these. It says, share a Coke with a first responder for EBC Community Hero Day. So as you go out today, make sure that you grab one of these and take that with you. Now, if you want to drink it, that's fine, but it's more of a commemorative thing. And so we appreciate that. And then we want to make sure that you and your families stay with us afterward. But we want to know who you are. And so if you'll do us a favor, will you tell us your name and who you serve with? And we'll start down here with at this far end down here.
David Watson, one of yours, retired from Newton Fire Department. I never have forgot the education. How many of you, by raise of hand, changed your batteries in your smoke alarms last night? Change your clock, change your battery. Oh my. I meant to say something about that in the first service. Think about that. That's a lifesaver.
Mark Stafford with Connor and Fire Department.
David Clark with Claremont Police Department.
Mark Henson, Connor Fire Department.
Michael Hefner with Bandy's Fire Department.
Dylan Hemline, Catfish Fire Department.
Riding the Highway Patrol.
Michael Hicks, Idaho County Sheriff's Office.
Gary Weaver, from the Fire Department.
Crystal Kennedy.
Don Brown, Newton Police Department.
Philip Austin, Catawba County Sheriff's Office.
Eric Laughlin, Connor Police Department. Preach on the taking at this
time. Oh, no.
I always want to thank Emmanuel Baptist Church because I don't look, Jeff, I don't look old. I've been at the Connor Police Department for a long time, and Emmanuel Baptist Church has always supported the Connor Police Department, always. When we first started our chaplain program, y'all have always had a pastor here on staff that's been part of our chaplain program. And the whole time Pastor Creel's been here, he's been one of the chaplains at the police department. And we razz him and we treat him just like he's a fellow officer when he comes by. He knows it. Look at him. Before he knew my children, I would send them and they would harass him too. So we love him. It's a lot of anger. Thank y'all for all that y'all do for the Potter.
Tyler Hamby, Connors Fire Department.
Corey Bullock, Connor Fire Department.
Jeff Hefner, Connor Fire Department.
Well, I'm retired from about everything you can think of. I'm a rural folk, retired state trooper, retired volunteer firefighter, and president of the fraternal police going on probably about 36 years. But thank y'all, and thank you for what you do.
Crystal Cross, Claremont Fire Department.
Earl Taylor, Claremont Fire Department.
Chris Boston, Connor Fire Department. Robert Rollins, Hickory Police Department.
Robert Gore, Catawba County 911.
Carl Green, Mecklenburg County MS. Wayne Eisenhower, Connor Fire Department. Darren Chin, Connor Fire Department. Daryl Hamby, Connor Fire Department.
Mike Nelson, Connor Fire Department.
Hang on. Is that young man on the back row not a volunteer?
Yes, he is.
Well, how about standing up? Tell us your name and who you serve with.
Harrison Wright, Connor Fire Department.
All right. Now you can. sure your family sits with you and all of that. So that, now, you want to stick around because there is probably 35 or 45 things that we're going to give away while we're down there. So by all means, make sure that you hang around. All right, sit back. Now the best is to come. We've already seen our heroes. Now we're going to have three of our heroes to speak. We're going to start off with Brother Jeff Barkley with Conover Police Department. So you come right on up, buddy. None of them are nervous either. So.
Accept a God that night. That's the best thing that's ever happened to me.
Amen.
As I continue growing up, you know, as kids, we all think about what we want to be. Of course, I wanted to be three different things. I wanted to be a truck driver and drive a big 18-wheeler. I mean, I think that was cool. I think that's what I wanted to do. The other thing was be a cowboy. Horses and shooting, all that stuff. The third thing was be a police officer. And growing up, like most people, I didn't become any of those right off. So I started off making pizzas and working in auto parts stores to doing construction. But you know what? During that time, I got married and had two wonderful boys. But I never was happy with my God made it available where I could go back and follow my dreams of not being a cowboy. Thanks to a very understanding wife, I was able to go back to school and work and go to school at night and become a police officer. Standing here 15 years later, I'm a lieutenant at Conover Police Department and love what I do. Love serving the community. In that fact, you know, I've wrote a lot of citations and I've taken a lot of people to jail. I've met some people that are good morally and I've met some people that are terrible. But through all that, I found it's not who we deal with, it's how we deal with those people. I've tried to live by this verse, John 15, verse 16 says, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. He ordained you that you should go forth and bring fruit, that your fruit shall remain, that whosoever shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. You know, God chose me a long time ago. Thank goodness he chose me. So over the years, I've tried, no matter what I'm doing, to show each person Christ in my life. I hope this verse will encourage you, as first responders or as regular people, to encourage somebody today. Encourage somebody through your life, no matter what you're doing or no matter what the situation is. You can always show Christ through your life.
That's right.
Amen. Amen.
Mark Stafford. Stafford, come on up here. I saw them in the back row, all the firemen passing out tomatoes. I don't know what that means. I met this feller, didn't I, years ago, and have watched him. And he is a wonderful fella. And he likes to harass people and poke at them just the same way we do. It's an honor to have you come speak.
I've got one. I'm Pastor Brown. I want to echo what Chief Lawton said. We treat him as we treat each other. Not too long ago, it was a Sunday morning. Pastor's up off early on a Sunday morning, come in, and just tugging at his tail. He said, "God, I just don't feel so well." And we just looked at him and laughed. Really, you was in bad shape, so we kind of snapped into gear and we started taking care of him. And thank God he's here today and feeling well. What a way to start off a Sunday morning with a baptism of a really young child. Again, we've said it many times this morning, thank you for allowing us to come and be with you this Sunday. Just to echo again what Chief Brown said, the church is not a building. A church is the people. And there's a lot of given parts sitting in this room today. We see from our standpoint what the church does for the community. I can't talk to you about it because we get to see a lot of good things and a lot of not so good things. If it's okay, I'd like to share a little bit about my testimony this morning. Back in April of 1987, some of you weren't born. I was attending a revival at a church. I live in Alexander County. I grew up with a grandfather who had an education from the Norine. He was a non-denominational pastor. I would come to my grandparents' home, and I would sit, and I would listen to him and his friends from college. What I thought at the time was argue Bible. Come to find out later, as I got older, it wasn't an argument. They were discussing. But it was the tone that they used that led me to believe they was arguing. At that point, as a young, a small guy, I didn't know the difference. Soon after I did, I learned. I knew that for me to spend eternity with God, that I needed to believe that God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for everyone's sins. April 23rd, I gave my life to Christ. In 1987. I'm not going to throw out too many numbers because y'all are going to figure out how old I am. I don't want that to happen. Jeff, you've done great this morning. It's very rewarding being in emergency services, whether it's law enforcement, you have your fire service, you have your EMS and rescue. This is one of the only jobs that you can go into and see the rewards. Now, you can focus on the negative. It's extremely easy in today's day and time to focus on the negative. And as you've heard this morning, usually when we get called to you, it's your worst day. I think God puts us in special places at special times to somewhat be a blessing, no matter how bad the circumstances are. But a lot of times it's the worst day at that point in time in their life on this earth. He puts us there and kind of leaves it up to us. I've had opportunities where I've been in a wrecked car with a patient, and I was able to somewhat witness and pray with them. And they've never forgot that. They've come back time and time again after that has happened. Not everybody can do that. Not everybody has the opportunity or is given the opportunity to do that. But this is the only job where you can go into the morning and work a 24-hour shift and see death. First call, your last call, you get to see a child. That makes for a full life. And my life is full. what makes it even better is I know where I'm going when I leave this earth. Without salvation, I wouldn't have any hope. I'm not a very polished speaker. Pastor Brian, he said, let God take over. And that's pretty much, I wrote some notes down and I'm just expanding on it. But without salvation, and the faith with salvation, you really have no hope. And you sit and you think, there is those out there who don't have what we have. It can't be bought. It can't be sold. It's a gift. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, and this, in the transitional period in my life, being a teenager and growing into adulthood, this always stood out to me because of someone is the fear of the unknown. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Now that can cause some anxiety, because you can apply that to almost something daily. But if you're a born again Christian, that's taken care of. There was a jolly old guy one day that called me into his office, and he gave me a piece of paper and it had Proverbs, three chapters, and several verses written down on it. And I'm not going to mention his name. He knows who he is. He said, "Read these. Study." I did. But one of the things that I used the entire book of Proverbs for is how I like to conduct or live my life, which is the way God wants to. That's why the book is in the Bible. I challenge young people, get rooted in Christ. Because it'll help you in the long run. Right. I'm still relatively young. I'm in a pulpit, I can't really stretch it. Get your feet rooted in Christ. Because you will need the rest of your days. A couple things you see on television today, and you may hear it on the radio. One of our guests or honorees today was speaking about saving lives. The guys that I have the opportunity to work with and work alongside, they know they're not going to hear me say, "Hey, let's go save a life." Some of our teachings that bring up saving lives. Please don't hold it against me, but I don't look at it like that. I look at it as God using us to do His work. Because there's only one person that can save you. And that's the God in the heavens. The one that we cannot wait to see. This will be the tough part of what I came to talk with you about this morning. And before I get to that, I'd like to read a verse out of Isaiah. Isaiah 41, chapter 10. For our professional life, this says it all. Isaiah 41, chapter 41, verse 10. "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." Folks, every answer is right here.
Amen.
You may read this Bible from cover to cover. It may not apply to your life the next day, the next week, or the next month. But I guarantee you somewhere down the road, something that you've come across and read will apply to your life. And it will apply on how you react and your attitude in general. September the 11th, I'm not going where you think I'm going. But September the 11th, to many people, is history. There's some kids in here that will be taught in schools about September 11th. This year, September the 11th, just after 1 p.m. I got the call that nobody would want to ever get. I got a call from my father's wife, and his heart stopped beating. I knew what my father's wishes was. I knew where my dad was going when he left this earth. And I had peace. I had peace because over time, I had been taught how to have peace. No peace. Keep it in mind. So September the 11th now has a new meaning for me. It has a new meaning for my family. It has a new meaning for, you know, the guys that was there with me that day. But one thing I want to leave you with, and it's in black and white, is the promise of God's gift to man, which is in John 3:16. First Bible verse I ever had to memorize. I had to memorize it to get a quad badge. And I was proud of that little crown. But I'm still going to read it from the book. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That is all you need. Thank you.
David is a lieutenant with the Claremont Police Department. And he stirred up trouble in the first ceremony.
Captain Lieutenant, y'all didn't speak near long enough for me to settle my nerves. I spoke to this morning with about half this crowd, and I was nervous as I could be. But myself, first of all, I want to thank God that he had mercy upon me. He passed by my way.
Amen.
And saved me as undeserving as I was. Still am. But he's not also saved me, but he's seen fit to keep. I want to start out by, again, thanking our pastor for recognizing each and every one of you, and I do as well. I thank all of you. Feel honored and privileged to stand among such great men and women and stand in uniform. But I feel even more honored that God passed by my way and chose me when he didn't have to. And I'll read Matthew chapter 5 and verse 9. It says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." Just like Mr. Barkley and so many others, that was my dream growing up as a child, to become a police officer. You know, I told him this morning, and I see, I don't know how Pastor does it every week, stand here and preaches two services that God gives him. And, but he does. He does it just the way God wants him to. And I told him this morning, and I'll tell y'all, that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to do exactly what God wants me to. I just want to be obedient to him. When the pastor called and asked me to speak, I thought the first same thing is, no, I don't want to. There's a whole lot of things that I've done for God that I didn't want to do, but that I knew I had to do for God. I grew up in a family that worked in furniture and textile, and up until I was 10 years old, I grew up in a house of domestic violence and whatever you can think of, until my grandmother took me in and raised me until I graduated high school and took me out of that life. And I guess that's why one of the reasons that I always wanted to become a police officer, I wanted to be a part of the solution and not a part of the problem. God didn't see fit to lead me into police work right after high school or whatever. I started working in furniture and textile like so many of us did, just like my family did. That's what I thought I was supposed to do. As time went on, I worked right down the road here, a place called Bassett, and God sent a young man my way that was just on fire for God like I'd never seen before. And he started witnessing to me and telling me about this God that had saved him and how excited he was about it. And as time went on, he kind of led me to another job. And as I started to work at this new place and me and my family started to get our head above water, if you will, for just a little bit. And God had seen fit, even though I hadn't become a Christian yet, been in and out of church all my life. I grew up in a little town called Maiden and probably visited most every church in that town. But I had a head knowledge, I guess, of being a Christian, but I never had the heart knowledge. But God had seen fit to send a man my way. It was a young preacher that was pretty much waiting to be voted in as a pastor of a church in Virginia. And as we began to work together and become friends, I started seeing in him something that I wanted. He didn't push it on me, wasn't trying to shove it down my throat, but every opportunity he got, he wanted to tell me about the God he served. One morning, I guess when it really hit me, is I stopped and on the way to work, and I bought him a breakfast sandwich, and I bought me one. We sat down to eat breakfast that morning, and I told him, I said, "Bud, I got you something to eat for breakfast." And as a tear rolled down his eye, he said, "Man, ain't God good." He said God knew that I didn't have anything to bring this morning. He said his wife had been on slow time, and he's just working through a temporary agency, waiting to be voted in as a pastor. And you know, for whatever reason, I guess that morning I seen how good God really was. Soon after that, on my way home from work, when it was just me and God, I asked God to save me. And he did. And I couldn't wait to get home and tell my wife. I couldn't wait to get back to work the next day and tell this young man that I'd got saved. And when I told him, and I'm not sure if it was the next day or not, but it was soon after that, he'd got voted in as the pastor. Me and him didn't understand at that time why God had sent him that way, but now we do. If nothing else, he sent him there so that I might find Christ as my Savior. And I continued to work in furniture for about 10 years after that, or maybe a little longer. As y'all know, the furniture and textile business began to go downhill. And a lot of people were losing their jobs to going overseas to China or whatever. And I was getting about in that position, but I had a friend of mine that worked with me and got killed at work one morning. And I thought to myself, "You know what, God, I know that you've got something else for me. And I don't know what it is," and God began to impress upon my heart that it was in law enforcement. I didn't know anything about being a police officer. Didn't even know where to get started. Brother Barkley here tonight was one of the people that kind of led me in the right direction. He was there, along with other people that God had put in my life. And said, "You know what, man, this is how you do it." Just like Jeff and others that helped me along the way. Showed me in the direction that I needed to go. About a year or so after that, I became a police officer. And you know, up until that point, I really didn't know, like I said, a lot about law enforcement other than I always wanted to help somebody, just like many of us here do. That's in our line of work. That's what we get into. We get into protect people, to help them along the way. And whether we realize it or not, that's exactly what we do. Not because we want to some days, but because God's impressed it upon us to do that. Because I believe it's a call. I can remember, I'll give you one story, that back on Christmas Eve, a 15-year-old young man passed away. I was called to go help work the investigation. For those of you in law enforcement, know how long that takes and how long it takes sometimes to move that person. And while we were there, and we were investigating and doing our job and waiting on someone to come and transport the body, I can remember the mother and a sister that had found that brother passed away that Christmas Eve. The family was upstairs waiting as they went down to get him, bring him up for the celebration when they found. down and passed. And she went back upstairs while we did our job, and like I said, it seemed like hours after that, she made her way back downstairs, and she was crying. Wanted to see her son again. I told her, I said, ma'am, I said, I know you do, but I promise you nothing's changed from the last time you were here. And I asked her, I said, ma'am, I said, if you don't mind, can I go with you back upstairs with your family and pray with you? She said, yeah, we did. We went back upstairs, and she and her family and I joined hands and gathered in the living room and prayed. When the Spirit of God just come down, and it seemed like it comforted my heart and theirs. And it's at that point that I guess that I knew that I was where God wanted me to be, doing the things that God wanted me to do. You know, we may not always see the future and what it holds and why we do the things that we do, but God's always got a reason for it. He's got a plan for each one of us. I've not been perfect, and I've not always been obedient to God, but I thank God that one day that he passed by my life and saw me. And I want to thank each and every one of you that pray for us and what we do, because I feel like your prayers is what carries most of us home safely every day. I thank you.
Saved because they knew the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. That's what makes the difference. In any of us's life, it allows us to be able to take another step, to go another mile, to see some of the things that they see, and all of that. And I've used this has been a different year for me, as Mark said. I had never been in the back of an ambulance. I'd never been rushed to the hospital. I'd never had any of that happen. And as he said, this year, walked in Sunday morning, and it changed my life. And the Lord saw fit to take care of me and use them and all. And I have a different perspective than I ever have. And many of them stopped by. Many of the people in attendance here this morning stopped by or sent messages and stuff. The thing that carried me through that was knowing the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. Didn't have a fear of dying. You say, well, I would have. Well, listen, when you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you know where if you stop breathing here and your heart ceases to beat here, you know where you next breath is. That's it. I hope you know that this morning, and that's why I asked these fellas to share this morning. Are they perfect? No. But let me say this to everybody in here. You're not perfect either. Not a single one of us. If you try to tell me you are, I'll ask you why. For your girlfriend or your boyfriend, and we'll find out real quick you're not perfect. And that's the beauty of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, is that he doesn't expect us to be. He knows that we are sinners. The Bible says, with God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5:8. He knows that we sin. But it said, as one of the fellows quoted John 3:16, for God so loved the world. He loved you and I. And he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The whole key is believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. It doesn't mean that you're perfect. Doesn't mean you're religious. Doesn't mean that you're a member of Emmanuel Baptist Church. Doesn't mean that you went through the baptismal waters, as Miss McKenzie did this morning. It means that there's a time in your life that you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And I hope that you never have to deal with the police, the fire, the EMS, as your life is flowing out of you. Hope you never have to. Hope you never have to. But should you, I hope that you know the Lord Jesus Christ is your personal Savior. I remember, I'll close with this story, having served with Conover PD and Conover Fire Department for all of these years, I've seen some things. And done some death notifications and all of that. Remember late one night riding with one of the officers from Conover, and the call come across about shots fired at where the CMB and the incline meet. The state trooper had been involved and pulled over somebody, and they fired and things of that nature. And there were some things that had happened, and because of what had happened and transpired, the officer shot the individual. I remember pulling up with the officer I was riding with, and I remember the gentleman as life fleeting from him. I remember him begging for just a drop of water. I don't know where he's in eternity, but I could not help but be reminded of the story in the book of Luke that speaks about that very thing. Know where you're going when you die, folks. Know where you're going. Don't leave it up for debate. Don't leave it to where your parents, your wife, your children don't know. The most important thing in this life is not things. It's knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. And these men have exemplified that this morning with how they do their job, with how they carry themselves, and how God orchestrates things that we don't even see. I hope this morning that you leave knowing the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. If you don't, we'll tell you how to. Just a minute. Before we close and have the invitation, I want to thank every one of our community heroes. You truly are the heroes of our community. We love you, we care about you, and if we at Emmanuel can ever do anything for you, you have an open invitation. Why? Because you are